During the First World War, the Scottish Women's Hospital units worked to save the lives of sick and wounded soldiers and civilians in war zones across Europe. The driving force behind this organisation was Dr. Elsie Ingalls from Edinburgh, one of the first women to become a doctor in the 1880s. She overcame prejudice and challenges in order to qualify. In the 1890s, Dr. Ingalls became involved with the women's suffrage movement to try to improve the lives of working class women across the country. By August 1914, when war was declared, she was nearly 50 and had already had a significant career in Edinburgh as a doctor and surgeon, specialising in treating women and children. Dr. Ingalls had also been involved in the voluntary aid detachment movement, which had been set up to train civilians to provide service to the war effort. Ingalls offered her services to the War Office, but was allegedly turned down by an official who responded with the words, "My good lady, go home and sit still." Other countries who were in serious need of medical support and nurses gladly accepted the offer of help from the Scottish Women's Hospital units. The first unit started work in France at the Abbey of Rojmo in 1914 and then in Kragujevac in Serbia in 1915. A fundraising campaign began with support from the National Union of Women's Suffrage Societies. This was soon extended to include funding from other organisations, individuals and communities. Flag days were organised and a system to sponsor hospital beds and wards was created. This meant that several hospital units were able to be set up. A wide range of staff were needed to run the hospitals. As well as doctors, surgeons and nurses, large numbers of support staff, including radiographers, cooks, administrators, orderlies and ambulance drivers were also needed. The women travelled from Britain, along with vehicles, equipment and supplies, and set up the hospitals from scratch. At Rojmo, under the guidance of Chief Medical Officer Dr. Francis Ivins, staff cleared out the disused Abbey building, scrubbed it clean, and then set up wards, an operating theatre, an X-ray room, and dispensary. Many of the hospitals had to deal with the arrival of large numbers of wounded soldiers all at once. They treated soldiers who had been gassed and those caught in heavy shelling with shrapnel injuries. Some patients were suffering from gangrene, frostbite, and advanced infections. Over 1,500 women signed up to work in the Scottish Women's Hospitals. They were from a variety of different backgrounds. Some were from affluent society families, others from crofting communities, as well as trained professional nurses. Some recruits came from other countries, including France and Australia. Many of the women volunteers had a strong sense of adventure and were attracted to the opportunity to travel and work in other countries, away from the strict customs and traditions that limited how women could live in Edwardian Britain. The hospitals were, however, well organised and disciplined units, and although some women did struggle with the rules, many lifelong friendships were formed between the staff and local communities. This was particularly the case in Serbia, where many of the hospitals were based, and strong bonds were formed between the local people and the women working in the hospitals. Many of the staff received military and national bravery decorations and commendations from foreign governments in the countries in which they served, including awards for treating the wounded while under fire. After the war, some of the staff returned to the countries in which they had been stationed and worked to rebuild communities. Nurse training schools were set up in Serbia, and children's homes were also established. Countries who had benefited from their service continue to celebrate the work of the Scottish Women's Hospital units, and the women who worked to save the lives of both soldiers and civilians. Anniversary events are held annually in Serbia to remember those who died in service. Dr. Elsie Ingalls died in November 1917 in Newcastle, shortly after returning from her last hospital trip in Russia. She had been ill for some time, but managed to hide this from colleagues. Her death was widely covered in the UK press, and her funeral was at St Giles Cathedral in Edinburgh, attended by royalty and dignitaries from the countries in which she served.